Hi there, welcome to another critical care nursing skills lesson. In this video, I'm going to discuss stroke volume as a determinant of cardiac output. Many of the same factors that regulate heart rate also impact cardiac function by altering the stroke volume. While several variables are involved, stroke volume is ultimately dependent upon the difference between end-diastolic volume and end-systolic volume, which I have already discussed in my previous video. Stroke volume has three primary factors to consider. These are the preload, or the stress on the ventricles before contraction, the contractility, or the force or strength of the contraction itself, and the afterload, the force the ventricles must generate to pump blood against the resistance in the vessels. Preload is the degree to which cardiac muscle cells are stretched from the filling of the ventricles before contraction. Therefore, preload is another way of expressing end-diastolic volume. With an increasing ventricular filling, both end-diastolic volume or preload increase, and the cardiac muscle itself is stretched to a greater degree. One of the primary factors to consider here is filling time, or the duration of ventricular diastole during which filling occurs. The more rapidly the heart contracts, the shorter the filling time becomes, and the lower the end-diastolic volume and preload are. This effect can be partially overcome by increasing the second variable, the contractility, which raises the stroke volume, but over time, the heart is unable to compensate for decreasing filling time and preload also decreases. And this relationship between ventricular stretch and contraction has been stated in the well-known Frank-Starling mechanism, or simply Starling's law of the heart, that we have already tackled in the previous video. Okay. Remember that any sympathetic stimulation to the venous system will increase venous return to the heart, which contributes to the ventricular filling and end-diastolic volume and preload. While much of the ventricular filling occurs while both of the atria and ventricles are in diastole or in relaxation, the contraction of the atria or the atrial kick plays a crucial role by providing the last 20 to 30% of ventricular filling. Now, here are the factors that affect the changes in preload. Preload may increase if there is fast filling time or increase in venous return. Increase in end-diastolic volume because of fast filling time or increased venous return will increase stroke volume, consequently increase cardiac output. On the other hand, preload decreases due to one or more of these factors: decreased thyroid hormones, decreased calcium ion, high or low sodium, low body temperature, hypoxia, abnormal pH balance, or some medicines or drugs like calcium channel blocker that can decrease heart rate. As you can see, all of these factors that can decrease preload are also can directly affect the heart rate, heart contractions, and venous return, because cardiac output determinants are interrelated and you cannot rule out other variables without affecting the others. All right, moving on. It is virtually impossible to consider preload and end-systolic volume without including the concept of contractility. Indeed, the two parameters are intimately linked. Now, how about contractility? Contractility refers to the force of the contraction of the heart muscle, which controls stroke volume, and is the primary parameter for impacting end-systolic volume, or the volume of the blood that remains in the ventricles after each contraction. The more forceful the contraction is, the greater the stroke volume and the smaller the end-systolic volume is. Consequently, the higher the cardiac output. On the other hand, the less forceful contraction results in a smaller stroke volume and larger end-systolic volume, and eventually lower cardiac output. Factors that increase contractility are described as positive inotropic factors, and those that decrease contractility are described as negative inotropic factors. Not surprisingly, sympathetic stimulation is a positive inotrope, whereas parasympathetic stimulation is a negative inotrope. Here are the factors that can affect changes in the force of contractility. A decrease in end-systolic volume are maybe cause of one of these factors or more of these factors: sympathetic stimulation, epinephrine and norepinephrine, high intracellular ions, high blood calcium level, thyroid hormones, and glucagon. So if there is a decrease in end-systolic volume, meaning the ventricle pump out more blood, and this will result in more stroke volume and consequently high cardiac output. On the other hand, increase in end-systolic volume are maybe due to one of these or more of these factors: parasympathetic stimulation, acetylcholine, hypoxia, and hyperkalemia. An increase in end-systolic volume is an indication that the ventricle pump out less blood, meaning there is a decrease in stroke volume, and also there is low cardiac output. All right. The third stroke volume determinant is the afterload. Afterload refers to the tension or force that the ventricles must develop to pump blood effectively against the resistance in the vascular system. Any condition that increases resistance, such as vasoconstriction or the disease atherosclerosis, requires a greater afterload to force open the semilunar valves and pump the blood. Afterload, also known as systemic vascular resistance, SVR, mechanism that causes vasoconstriction increases SVR, and those mechanism that causes vasodilation decreases SVR. Although systemic vascular resistance is primarily determined by changes in blood vessels diameters, changes in blood viscosity also affects SVR. Actually, systemic vascular resistance can be calculated if the cardiac output, mean arterial pressure, and central venous pressure is known or available. And the equation for that is systemic vascular resistance equals parentheses mean arterial pressure minus the central venous pressure and divided by the cardiac output. We will have a more detailed discussion of this in my video about blood pressure. Okay, factors affect changes in afterload. Okay, increased vascular resistance, semilunar valve damage, and any condition that causes resistance in pumping the blood against the semilunar valve increases end systolic volume, thus decreasing stroke volume and resulting in a low cardiac output. On the other hand, any condition and factors causes decreased vascular resistance like vasodilation decreases end systolic volume and increases stroke volume, consequently increases cardiac output. Alright guys, that's the end of the lesson in this video, and we will continue hemodynamics lesson in my next video.